And look at this cute guy. I feel like these could be sometimes fickle in Utah.
The laurels?
No.
Oh, the lupins?
The lupin. But yeah. Looks pretty dang happy. Sometimes it's like, talk to us about lupin a little bit, because some people tell me they need to be in full sun. I don't think that's the case. I think they do a little bit better with some shade, but they can't have too much.
Lupins,
I don't know. They're
The thing with lupins is that they really like drainage more than anything.
Mm-hmm.
They like their water. They're not a low water plant in any way, shape, or form, but they don't like to sit in water. The other finicky thing about lupin is that they do not like to be moved, so you lose a lot during transplantation. Like, we lose a lot of the nursery just transplanting.
Yeah, it's rough.
So, and the best time to plant lupin is really probably April, like the first part of April when it's a little bit cooler. They just really don't like to be moved around in the heat all that much. So, like, when we sell them...
So beware if you want to transplant yours. If you have one that's happy, you might want to think twice.
Yeah, don't ever move them. And, like, honestly, Jess, like, every time that I've tried... I mean, I lose, like, 9 out of every 10 that I try to plant down here in the valley, you know, if I try to do it myself, mostly because I just don't pay attention. You know, but they can work.
It's a holiday,
so I mean, it's just, you know, the soil structure out here in older neighborhoods seems to be a lot better than when you get out to like some of the new developments, like out in, in Copperton or you know, some of the Daybreak areas, Eagle Mountain. Those places are really hard just because it's such compacted soil. But out here, it's all been, you know, organic material. It's been cultivated here for 150 years now. Like, when did the pioneers get here? 1840 something, seven?
Too long.
Something like that.
Yeah.
So you have so much organic matter, so much soil structure now because of all of the cultivation that's happening, that you can get away with a lot more things over here than what you can get away with in newer developments. So.
Well, and they didn't have any issues with water type either.
No. No, here the water's actually really, really good.
Yeah.
So it just comes from the mountains right here.
Which is great.
But we actually have some more lupin over here. We did this, because I think this one over here...
Oh, we didn't come over to this side of the house.
We didn't. This lupin right here is called the Governor. That's the same one that's in that Facebook picture that everybody's like, oh my gosh, that lupin.
It was huge.
And I was like, no, I got lucky with that one.
It was stunning. That could have been in a... contest or something. I don't know.
Yeah. And so then we've got
columbine.
Yeah, we've got some columbine. This is the Aquilegia alpina. It's actually one of my favorite. And this geranium is called Boom Chocolata.
The names they come up with, it's just awesome.
Yeah. But then we've got this lupin that's called this is My Castle.
Yes, My Castle, I was just gonna say.
Yeah, but I love the red colors on it, and it's actually been really good around here.
And it's nice because it's an unexpected pop on this side, because we've got the double knockouts, and again, you're pulling that through. I think that's really important to point out the pattern that is very subtly showing its way through the entire property. And then we have these lovely fine lines. The thing I love about fine lines is the texture. They're so feathery.
They are really feathery. And you know, it's one of those plants that actually doesn't mind growing in a little bit of shade either, because we've got these big old huge Austrian pines above us, and it gets a little bit of filtered sun, and they're still just, you know, happy as clams over here.
Well, and sometimes you get like a little bit of a different appearance out of them. Mm-hmm. These ones are a little more soft and floppy. Mm-hmm. Sometimes when I see them in full sun, they tend to look more like a high desert plant.
Yeah.
But in this application, they look definitely, I don't know, almost like a bamboo type situation.
Yeah.
And so it changes their character completely. We've got a Rose of Sharon, I think.
Yep, that's a, it's a
here.
Purple pillar.
Oh, so it's going to stay nice and skinny.
So it's going to stay nice and skinny. And then on the other side, I forgot to talk about those, but I actually did 3 purple pillars in a row.
Oh, I saw those.
So it's going to be like a natural
wall.
Fence type of thing.
Some privacy.
Yep, give them some privacy.
And that'll be nice to have that color there later in the season. Yeah, the pillars. So Cameron's paying attention to size, making sure, because how wide do the fine lines get?
2.5 feet tops.
Mm-hmm. And then the purple pillar.
Yeah, maybe 2 to 3 feet tops.
So do we have room for both?
Yes.
We do.
The other thing
size matters, people. Size matters.
The other thing too is that these, the one thing I don't like about columnar shrubs a lot of times, is that they have really ugly feet. So, you know, fine lines are notorious for it because they always end up being kind of bare down here.
Yeah.
But that does give you an opportunity for some creativity going forward where you can put in a lot more perennials, get
underneath.
A lot more color through here.
Yep.
You know, and I left them some room for that. They just haven't really taken advantage of it yet.
They're getting there.
So
there's
always,
the other thing.
Always more space.
You have to be patient too. Like sometimes I tell people, please exercise some restraint. When stuff first goes in, it takes some time. And we're looking at a 3-year-old property. And in my opinion, it's filled out really nicely. But some people might look at this and have an urge to pop in some annuals and just kind of go crazy. But you can really mess up the design flow doing that. So it is. It's sometimes it's a practice in patience, definitely, when you're waiting for the full potential of your design to come through. I wanted to highlight these plumbago too. I actually use them a lot in a space like this.
Underneath a spruce?
Underneath a spruce. Why is that, Cameron?
Because it was the only thing that could grow in sun and shade, probably be a little bit drought tolerant and try to compete with these tree roots just a little bit.
Well, and they don't mind the pine needles. That's what I love about them is they will grow. Because it's challenging for some plants to be under an evergreen.
It is. There's like not a whole lot of light that happens. The other thing too with conifers is that they have a lot of times a little bit shallower root systems, and so there isn't a whole lot of soil mass. And these things are giant straws, so they just suck so much moisture out of the ground. One of the garden myths that I'm always addressing is the pine needles acidifying the soil, which is not true. The reason why
they take it forever.
What's that?
Well, the needles have to they have to break down.
Yeah,
it's a process.
By the time that they break down, they're pH neutral anyway.
So, yeah.
But the main reason why it's so hard to get things to grow underneath conifers is really just the aggressive root systems and the amount of shade that ends up coming from a tree this size.
It's just why your grass usually hates it there.
Exactly.
But these guys, you can't see it right now, but once they get going, it's a blue flower. And blue is not an easy color to come by in florals. That's why I love those delphiniums so much.
Yeah.
And they go. They go.
And what's really cool is late in the season, when they're still blooming, their fall color goes that orange.
Tell us the fall color.
It's a kaleidoscope of orange and yellows and reds and purples.
The leaf
all with
color.
These blue flowers.
It's like an amber red with the blue flower still on it. It's
looks amazing.
Like any other. It's so unique.
Yep. And it's a really gentle ground cover as well. It's not like a vinca or a bishop's weed that'll just spread everywhere that you can't control.
It's not too invasive at all.
Yeah, it's pretty easy to play with those.
Buy plumbago. What else should we highlight? Anything else? I think we've got it. These guys are lucky because you're not doing design as much anymore.
Nope. Not.
So if you want to try to get him to design your yard, good luck. You're going to have to throw him the sun, the moon, and the stars.
Well, you better just hire Jessica then. She'll do it for you.
Well, I love the design process, obviously.
Oh, they're breaking stuff over there.
But yeah, gorgeous yard. Lucky homeowners to have Cameron do the design.
Thanks.
It's excellent.
Well, thanks for coming out and hanging out with us, Jess.
Yep.